Hey guys, Halfway Dead here. There are already two great videos on the topic of Rocket League's netcode, one of them being by Cynox Cohen himself. I highly recommend watching both, but because a lot of people ignore these recommendations, I'm going to cover the basics in this video too, even though it's just a repetition. Let's start with the reason we need a netcode. Delay. When everything is running on your computer, the physics and inputs can all be used pretty much immediately to determine the physics outcome. Unfortunately, when playing online, the data needs to travel in between all participating players. The upper limit for how fast information can travel is the speed of light. Berlin and Washington are 6,700 kilometers or 4,200 miles apart. It takes light 22.4 milliseconds to travel that distance one way and 44.8 if you include the way back. In real-world scenarios, the ping is going to be much higher than 45 milliseconds, but the point I'm trying to make is that there are physical limitations that make it impossible to not have delay. Delay always creates a problem. Let's say player A jumps. However, this information arrives at player B's computer 50 milliseconds later. In that time, player B has already demoed player A. Yet from player A's perspective, he has successfully avoided the demo, having jumped 100 milliseconds ahead of where player B is. So how do we deal with this problem? First of all, we need an unbiased entity. The server. It's not going to be able to get rid of the delay altogether. However, it is vital to making online games fair. The state of the server physics always gets treated as the true state of the game. If the server determines that player A was indeed demoed, then that might still frustrate them, but it will ensure that each player has the same opportunity and player B has equal edge cases, assuming both players have the same ping to the server. Always preferring the person jumping or demoing would just create even more ridiculous looking edge cases. Alright, with a server in place and having established that some delays are unpreventable, what can the game actually do against lag? The key concept is prediction. Take the ball as the easiest example. If we have 100 ping, which means it takes 100 milliseconds for data to travel to the server and back, then the ball location from the server will be arriving 50 milliseconds late on our screen. The ball would not actually be in the spot where we think it is. And since the server is always considered the true state, we could end up missing the ball because it has already moved past us on the server. It gets even worse though. Our inputs also take 50 milliseconds to get to the server, which means that the difference of what you see on your screen and what the server sees would be off by the full 100 milliseconds. Here's where the prediction netcode does its magic. Since the ball follows the deterministic physics, the game can actually calculate where the ball will be 100 milliseconds later than the data that came from the server. That is enough time for our inputs to reach the server at the correct moment. If you think about it, you're also predicting your own car because only the server determines the true state. This system actually works so well that you can play by yourself on a server with 340 ping, and as long as the connection is stable, the car-ball interactions will be the same as playing offline. Mathematically, this would even be true with 30 seconds of ping, but no connection is 100% stable and a higher ping makes each of the inconsistencies worse. The real problems start when the game tries to predict other players' cars. They still follow the principles of Rocket League's physics, but there's no way to know what the opponent's input is going to be 100 milliseconds ahead of when the actual data arrives. But there are best assumptions that we can make. If they were doing nothing, then it is assumed that they're still doing nothing. If they were boosting, then it is assumed that they're still boosting. The same is true for accelerating, braking, turning, power sliding, jumping, as well as pitch, yaw, and roll in the air. The times where they will start or stop to boost, jump, and such are unknown, and as a result, the timing of dodges is also unknown. Whenever the prediction of the client is different from the server, their states will be out of sync, which is why it's called a desync. Once the data from the server has arrived, however, the cars on your PC will be adjusted to their correct location, speed, etc. Here are a couple of examples with 340 ping. Boosting, which shows as acceleration so fast that it shouldn't be possible. This happens because the client has to overcorrect once it knows that the player has already been boosting for a third of a second. And dodges, where it looks like the car is basically teleporting due to the abrupt speed increase. Earlier I said that the ball prediction works amazing, yet everyone can probably name a lot of scenarios where they saw massive desyncs with the ball. That is just because there are constant interactions with the ball. If the cars touching the ball can't be predicted perfectly, then the ball can't be either. For example, with a ping of 100 milliseconds, if another player's input causes a change in speed, location, rotation, or angular velocity less than 100 milliseconds before they hit the ball, then the ball will first get predicted incorrectly until the update from the server arrives. This becomes especially apparent in 50-50s where multiple players dodge into the ball. The prediction can go wrong once for every player, and every time the client gets an update for a player dodge, it will change the direction of where the ball seems to go. Another horrible scenario happens when someone is on a collision course with the ball, but dodges at the last possible moment and ends up not hitting it. Unfortunately, these kind of desyncs are again unavoidable based on how high your ping is. I've often heard people complain about the server when this happens, and while it can be the case that a poor server exaggerates this and makes it happen a lot throughout the entire game, if it only happens once in a game, then it was probably an extreme example where you just have to concede that playing games over the internet can never be perfect. I haven't yet talked about the specific parts of the game that don't get predicted, such as scoring a goal. If the goal explosion was predicted, but on the server the ball was barely saved, then that would just create a worse scenario than the bit of delay that you usually have on goal scoring. If you're the player trying to save the goal, the current implementation can allow you to seemingly save it after it is already a goal on the server, which is frustrating, but the opposite would be worse. Another aspect that doesn't get predicted is the ball hitting the floor to end the game. Only when the server says that the game is actually over will it stop on your screen. By that time, the ball has usually bounced in the air again, and possibly even into someone's net. But once again, the opposite would be worse. The kickoff timer also doesn't get predicted, but in this case I am not sure if that is on purpose. You can start boosting before the timer ends on your screen, and the car will do so on the server, which means you can arrive at the same time to the ball. But it would look like you teleported the first couple of meters. This is once again footage of terribly high ping, but it still seems like an unnecessary issue. When you're driving over a boost pad, the client will also not predict whether you will get the boost or not. That is not optimal when you're the only one near the boost pad, but if any other player was close enough to steal it and your client predicted wrongly, that would arguably be worse. Unlike the kickoff, it's impossible to use the boost before the client gets the update that it did indeed get the boost. Let's talk about some of the technical details of the netcode. So far, I've only talked about data getting sent back and forth and not really about what is getting sent and how often. For your car, all the game does is send the inputs straight to the server. It's not actually sending that you've pressed the X button on your controller. It does so in an abstract manner. Whether you have the boost pressed, jump pressed, or whatever your current steer percentage is. This approach makes it impossible for the player to teleport around the map or have speed hacks. The server does send the actual game state back, however. That is of course necessary in order for your computer to check if the prediction is still correct and adjust it if it isn't. Each of these chunks of data are called a packet. They are getting sent at a regular rate between the server and client to ensure that they stay in sync. Based on my testing, the amount of packets that you receive from the server is always 60 per second. A bit more complicated is the send rate. It seems pretty unstable, anywhere between 65 to 70. At maximum, it sends one packet per frame though, which means if you cap your FPS to stable 65 or below, then the packet send rate seems to be more stable. I couldn't find any benefits to that though. For some reason, the client send rate and server send rate options, as well as the bandwidth limit in the menu, do not seem to make any difference at all. Shout out to Reddit user YouNextHill, who originally showed this to me. I did retest everything myself, however. If it gets fixed in a future update, I will report on it. What different types of lag can you have? My previous examples were mainly showing high latency, which is subpar to low latency, but the other potential issues are usually the ones that make the game literally unplayable. Server health. Rocket League's support website says that this is a scenario where the server itself is experiencing issues like eating up too much memory. In that case, the server might not be able to run the physics simulation in real time anymore. Everyone's computer still does though, but since the server is considered the ground truth, the state of everyone's game will get reset to the server state whenever it manages to send out the next update. That will cause those scenarios where you see and replay the same situation multiple times, but only the last one is actually the one that happened on the server. It is important to know that server health does specifically not say anything about how good the internet connection of the server is. Usually it should be great, because the servers are located in data centers with the best data connections you can have. But if the server has packet loss, then every player playing on the server will get the packet loss icon and not the server health icon. Which gets me to explain what packet loss is. It could be that data sent from the server or the player never arrives at its destination. That is obviously terrible when playing a game. If the client doesn't get an update from the server, then it goes on trying to predict the game. Any desyncs get worse when you don't get an update for a while. But that doesn't even compare to how horrible the experience is that you get when your inputs get lost on the way to the server. You could press your jump button, but the server thinks you never jumped. Turns feel sluggish, you start warping around the field, you have no control over your car. To mitigate this issue, the game seems to send the inputs of the last 4 physics ticks. That way, if you're playing at 60 plus FPS, you can have 1 out of 2 packets dropped without an issue. In reality though, it's very common to drop 2 to 3 packets in a row when the connection is bad. Best of luck to you if you do. Latency variation or jitter is also a big issue. The truth is that packets can always arrive a couple of milliseconds later than usual. That is why the server and the client both have a small buffer. They basically increase the latency on purpose so that when a packet does arrive a bit late, it's not a problem. It's the lesser of two evils. Because in a real-time application, if a packet arrives too late, then it is basically the equivalent of a packet not arriving at all. The server doesn't have any use for a jump press that happened 1 second ago. It is not going to rerun the simulation just because it has that information now. Latency variance is basically all about choosing the right buffer size. You don't want it too large because it's going to increase the average delay, but you certainly wouldn't want it too small because that gives a worse experience. Unfortunately, the buffer on the server is the same for everyone, so if your variance is too high for the set buffer, then you're out of luck. So what can you do against these issues? If it is the server, then you can look at the name and report that to the support team. However, it is highly unlikely that the issue has anything to do with the server if not everyone on the server experiences the issue. I feel like I see people daily blaming the servers when only one player's connection is bad. So if it's not the server, what can you do? In general, you should avoid Wi-Fi at all costs because it is prone to packet loss and variance. If you already do that and you still have regular issues, then talking to your ISP is probably your best bet. There's no guarantee that they will do anything, but there's no one else that can do anything. Tell them the exact issue that you're having and ask for instructions on what data they need from you to fix the connection to the servers. Lastly, I want to quickly talk about the ping on the scoreboard. it is only correct when using 60 FPS. If you get more frames, it shows a higher ping, and if you get less, it shows a lower ping. If I lock my frame rate at 15, it displays a ping of 0 milliseconds, which obviously can't be correct. I imagine that the measurement includes some processing delay, and they subtract a frame of time, which works out at 60 FPS but does not hold true at any other frame rate. Shout out to my patrons who make it possible for me to spend this much time on creating videos. If you want to help me too, then you can do so at the link on screen. In return, you get some sneak peek information on future videos and a vote to prioritize certain topics over others. If you want to stay up to date about this channel, follow me on Twitter or join my Discord, and I'll see you guys soon for the next video.